Hello, my name is Marius and this is the HPC NRW tutorial on CUDA C. So, what is CUDA for C and C++? Let's ask NVIDIA. The CUDA C++ programming guide says, CUDA C++ extends C++ by allowing the programmer to define C++ functions, called kernels, that, when called, are executed n times in parallel by n different CUDA threads, as opposed to only once, like regular C functions. Thank you, NVIDIA Programming Guide. Let's try to simplify that. CUDA C is just C with GPU functionality. To be honest, that isn't too helpful either. So, let's take a more detailed look. CUDA C extends C. It comes with its own compiler, the NVIDIA C compiler, or short NVCC. But that one only takes care of the CUDA C specific parts and uses an external C compiler like GCC for the rest. That means to understand CUDA, we need to look at its additional functionalities. The most important new concept in CUDA C are kernel functions. A kernel function is a data parallel function that is executed on the GPU or device and called from the CPU or host. It is defined by the kernel function modifier global and requires a number of blocks and threads per blocks to run on, given at function call. These numbers are passed using the characteristic triple angular bracket syntax. When called with m blocks and n threads per block, the kernel function is evaluated n times m times, which also is the number of threads spawned. These threads are all identical, except for the thread and block ID, which you have to use to distribute the workload over the threads. Block ID X and thread ID X are automatically defined inside a kernel to make this possible. For the kernel function to do anything, we need our data copied to the GPU memory. To copy data anywhere, we first need to allocate memory. That's what CUDA malloc is for. It does exactly what the standard C malloc would do, requesting memory and assigning a pointer to it, but on the video RAM. It requires a device pointer, aka a device variable name, and the size in bytes the variable or array will take up. Additionally, it returns a CUDA-specific error code, but that's not relevant in this tutorial. To finally copy our data, we use CUDA memcopy, which again works similar to the standard C memcopy, but allows for the device memory as another target. The only maybe unexpected thing is that we have to tell the function whether source and destination pointer are supposed to be in the CPU or GPU. In principle, CUDA memcopy can take care of all of the four possible combinations. But shouldn't a modern programming language be able to take care of all of that? Sure, and CUDA is no exception. CUDA malloc manage takes care of allocating memory on the host and the device, and has both allocations automatically synchronized. It even gets to the same performances as manual copies would get. Its only downside is that it only works for Pascal architectures and newer. That basically means you have to be using an NVIDIA GPU from 2016 or later, which of course isn't always the case. Using these functions, let's try to get the SAXPY onto the GPU. As a reminder, for the SAXPY, we need to copy two arrays to the device memory, compute a times x plus y there, and then copy back the results. In CPU-only code, shown here, this is quickly done, since we do not need any copies. Now, this is the CUDA C version of that code. Let's go through this from the beginning. Since CUDA is just an extension to C adding additional functions, we have to include its library. Also, we just define our array dimension to be n, in this case 6. The only function we have to define is the SAXPY kernel itself. It requires 3 arrays and a number as parameters. The arrays need to exist on the device memory, where the number can be passed by value. Our kernel now does the easiest thing possible and just computes a single entry in each thread. This isn't particularly efficient, but hey, it's a SAXPY. Moving to our main routine, we declare and initialize our arrays and set up the corresponding device arrays, which we then allocate on the GPU memory. Next, we copy the data to the device. Finally, we can call our kernel using a single block and 6 threads. In the end, we copy the results back to the host. Of course, to do actual timings with this, we need to use multiple blocks and larger arrays. And we would need to actually measure and output the times. But this code should give you a general idea. So let's quickly recap what timings we expected for the comparison between CPU and GPU. Keep in mind that this is a double logarithmic plot, and we give arbitrary units on both axes, since all of this greatly depends on the task, its implementation, and the system configuration. That being said, for the CPU, we should be getting a linear relation between array dimension and computation time. On the GPU, we have to consider that the data needs to be copied first, creating a constant overhead. This makes the CPU faster for small computations, while the GPU's overhead can be neglected for large datasets, and its superior computation power finally pays off. And that's exactly what we see in our measurements. If you don't look at the wiggles and the curves and the small overhead for the CPU, then these lines agree quite well with our model. Maybe we would expect a larger gap between CPU and GPU for a large n, but that's on us for not optimizing the code perfectly and using a very simple problem. To achieve more than about 30% speedup shown in this plot, we need a task with higher arithmetic intensity. So much for the CUDA C, and see you in another video.